thank you also on my behalf to Raising the Assembly for having us all here today, and thank you to all of you for sticking around until the very end. It's very good. I'm going to be talking about a piece of research that was commissioned by the Building Change Trust and that we carried out over 2 years on the independence of the voluntary sector in Northern Ireland. And I suppose before I start, a couple of caveats that I'd like to put out there. First of all, the presentation and the reports that we've written, they of course talk about the sector in rather generic terms. But one thing that was very obvious from the very beginning, that's quite a problematic thing to do, in that it is such a bewilderingly complex ecosystem of organizations of different sizes, different types, working in different policy areas, in different geographical spaces, that, you know, from the very beginning, it's a bit of a problem to talk in those terms. But of course, we have to say something, summarize this in some way. So if there's representatives of organizations here, for example, and they think, well, this doesn't quite apply to me, then maybe that's to do with the diversity of things as well. The other thing is that as we were doing this research, it became apparent that there is something of a kind of a gear change in the relationship between the government and the sector that was ongoing. So we feel we captured something that was very much in that moment of change, which then makes it a little bit more difficult to say anything definite about it, except to give you a snapshot of what was taking place. But nevertheless, you know, we'll give you what we can on our take on where we were at the time. So this is based on research that we completed about a year and a half ago, and it was launched October-November time in 2016. So the findings kind of relate to that sort of time period. What we tried to argue is that the era of partnerships, which is the kind of, you know, harking back 20, 25 years to the kind of the policies of Tony Blair and New Labour that were very strong on the partnership element of the way in which the voluntary sector was incorporated in new ways of governance, new ways of service delivery, that is not coming to an end necessarily, but it is changing fundamentally. And this decoupling of the sector and the government and this kind of strong partnership is something that we tried to capture in this research. Partly, that is simply due to austerity and the limited resources that are available and the smaller pot of money over which charities are trying to share, find their own share from. And partly, I think, it's due to different modes of commissioning or contracting out services and the greater competition there amongst not only voluntary organizations, but private sector organizations as well. And what we're kind of suggesting is that there are different ways in which this then pans out in the future, trying to anticipate the future a little bit. That on one hand, we have organizations that are moving in this more into the service space, becoming mainstream contractors for the sector, for the government, delivering services in their areas of specialty. But that others who are not quite so well placed to do that in the future, where you are looking at larger contracts and larger capacity from organizations to deliver, then you're looking for other options. And one of them is perhaps the rediscovery of the more radical and the more community-based roots of organizations, going back to the communities where they've kind of come from to some degree and moved into the service delivery space. And finding the kind of energy and legitimacy for their work from there. But also, because this is, of course, a piece about independence, or research about independence, then thinking about to what extent does the independence of voice, purpose, and action, which I'm going to be talking about a bit more in the next few slides, is something that we need to really rethink and bring back into what it is that the voluntary sector is about. So beginning then with the independence of purpose, which regards the extent to which organizations remain true to the mission and values of their organization. And just to bring you one finding from our survey, so that the research was based on a survey of voluntary sector organizations and on about 60 semi-structured interviews with a range of stakeholders, both from government and the sector. One of the interesting findings was that when we compared those organizations that said most of their funding came from government to those where majority said, or they said the majority of funding came from different sources, non-governmental sources, there was a difference in the extent to which independence seemed to be of value to the organizations. So there may be some degree of self-selection that goes into the type of work you go into. So if you go into contracting work, commissioned work from the government, then that concern over independence is perhaps not something that your organization is so concerned with. Maybe it's to do with the policy field or the area of work you operate in, or maybe there's some other reasons. But it seems that there's an interesting sort of a divide within the sector in how important independence is to the organization and where you look for funding. Those seem to kind of match up to some degree. So you see 55% of those who get government funding think independence is important versus 82% for those organizations that receive funding from other sources. Now, if you look at independence of voice, which has to do with the extent to which organizations feel that they can freely exercise their voice in critique of government and other entities as well, without having that fear of losing their funding or losing their support. And again, just a snapshot single finding that I wanted to highlight is that when we look at organizations and we look at the degree to which non-management or people within non-management positions feel about this compared to those who are in managerial positions, there's a difference in that those who are in managerial positions feel the organization are more critical than they are to other members of staff. So how can we explain that? What's actually going on here? One of the explanations that I would put forward is that something actually may happen behind closed doors, that there's what's called insider tactics in trying to influence government policy, that it is more about picking up a phone, perhaps talking to attending meetings and talking about issues behind closed doors and expressing that critique in those kinds of spaces, which would not be visible or audible to the rest of the staff in the organization. So it may not be aware of that work that happens. So the explicit outsider tactics of having public campaigns, of having a very public critique of say government policy may be shifting away from the kind of the operational domain of organizations. And they're using these kind of insider tactics more. And of course that then may raise questions about the state of and the health of deliberative democracy in Northern Ireland, and to what extent should voluntary organizations be at the forefront of keeping that sort of conversation alive, and is something happening here, perhaps as part of the contracting and the commissioning environment where you have certain types of relationships that are strengthened by that, but which may lead to more closed conversations about how policy is shaped and not the open conversation. There's a wrong order in the slides there. And then finally, independence of action. So this refers to the extent to which organizations can feel they can be creative and innovative and even risk-taking in the types of activities that they come up with or they provide. And importantly, innovative in the sense that that will meet the needs of the beneficiaries of the organization. And here, there's a fairly robust consensus around the feeling that the current system of funding does not allow for a great deal of flexibility and innovation in how you provide the services, that it is one size fits all, or certainly that there's once you are in a service providing relationship, there's not a huge amount of flexibility about how you go about delivering that service. But the other finding I wanted to share here as well is that there's quite a strong sense within the sector, based on our findings, that the competition that results from the current funding environment, which is mainly characterized by a shift from a grants-based funding to contracts-based funding, that there's a lot more competition among organizations that erodes trust, that erodes collaboration between organizations. And this is actually... the sense of this is stronger among chief executives than it is among the general sample in our survey. So So I've talked about this threefold sense of independence around voice, purpose, and action, which is what we started the work with. And we used this as a kind of a framing, a way of asking questions about what independence means. But the more we asked these questions, the more it became obvious that these were not really concepts that are intuitive, or indeed, they are something that mean different to every organization or individuals. They weren't really giving us kind of the analytical tools to really think about what independence means. So the more we churned the data and the more we thought about it, the more obvious it became to us that actually what's important is the relationships, that independence is sort of expressed in the relationships that organizations have. So a bit like you have a genotype that is in your chromosomes and in your genes, and you have a phenotype, which is what it actually looks like. It's the relationships, and when we look at them, that we can actually tell something more about what independence means and what impact it has, whether it's eroding or whether it's shaping the organizations in some way. So we then suggest this four-way typology of characteristics of behaviors of organizations. And I don't mean that organizations fit into a particular box, but they may borrow from a whole range of these to kind of characterize their response to, say, eroding independence. So the first one is the agent, which refers to organization that works largely like an arm of government. They deliver services to a pre-written script and are quite comfortable in that space. Then there is the organization that we called a mimicker. So it may enter into that, say, service delivery space and take over from public sector bodies that used to be doing that work, or private sector bodies. But as it does that work, it may come up against challenges or difficult decisions. And as it makes decisions about how to move forward in that and develop as an organization, it tends to mimic those that it's now working with. So absorb practices and absorb ways of thinking, ways of structuring its work that are closer to the private sector or the public sector. So in the literature, we talk about isomorphism. So you morph or change into something that is more at an equilibrium with those organizations that you now work with. So because there's a closer relationship with the public sector, for example, then you start to assume certain characteristics in your decision making or in your practices. And then the characteristic of a competitor, which I've already alluded to. So organizations are becoming increasingly competitive because of partly a dwindling funding resource, but also because of the way in which you access it is through a competitive tendering. And the collaborative relationships and the trust relationships in a kind of horizontal way between organizations begin to matter less. And what matters more is the vertical funding relationship with the organization that holds the resources. And finally, we've described the organizations as being reticent, or some of them. So actually beginning to withhold back on their criticism of government policy or other policy simply because there is a fear of that critique. Whether it's true or not, it's difficult always to say, but the assumption is within organizations very often that that critique of government policy does lead to potential challenges to their funding. There's also an element where it's easier for organizations to blame their critique for why they lost the funding rather than the quality of the delivery of the service. I think that's another element of it. And, you know, I think there's an open debate about what are the actual consequences. But there's a very strong sense, an impression, definitely, that this is the reality, and it shapes behavior. It definitely shapes behavior and it shapes attitudes within the sector. So this diagram tries to summarize the entire 2 years' work. And what we're trying to say here is that we are kind of shifting from the dominant, so far dominant, partnership narrative of joint up working, of working within network governance, together, the voluntary sector and government developing policies, partly and largely through a crisis of resources, which has to do with austerity to some degree and the limited or the reduced funding base for voluntary organizations. And in fact, I think in Northern Ireland in particular, voluntary sector was at the forefront of taking the hit when it came to cuts, at least at the in the early stages, because it was a relatively unproblematic place to impose some of those cuts. And while some of that has changed, I think the nature of the relationship is changing. And this is the kind of main thing that we want to suggest, is that we're now in this different phase, which is more instrumentalist, more of a decoupling of the government and the sector's relationship, where the partnerships that continue to exist are more based on sort of instrumental calculations of how do you meet the needs of delivering the service rather than anything else. And at this time, because of the rationalization that will inevitably take place, there will be winners and losers. Some of this has to do with the larger contracts that are being tendered out, which means that it is more difficult for small organizations to be part of that space and to be part of those competitions. So there will be, to some degree, we called it a crisis of existence, of, well, where do we go from here? This was very strongly communicated in the interviews that we did, that organizations did express very serious concerns about the future, going beyond the one-year funding cycle and what would happen in the next one, and concerns over staff that were on yearly contracts as a result of the nature of the funding. And we suggest that, well, there's, obviously, we don't have a crystal ball, but different avenues for progress from here that may have to do with what I've suggested earlier, a rediscovery of some of those original, if you like, community roots, a more radical practice. The legitimacy of the organizations will be based on the fact that they, not that they deliver policies, but they have very genuine roots in the communities from where they operate. And I think it is fair to say that in some instances, some of that has been lost over the last 20 years as the sector has become increasingly professionalized, providing a better service, but perhaps not always on the terms of the communities which it claims to represent, or not to the same degree as used to be the case. But also, seeing as we're talking about independence, perhaps there is an element of rethinking about the real values of the independent voice, independent purpose of the organizations, and the independent, innovative, flexible action that is really focused on what the beneficiaries and the communities need and how you best deliver it. And there may be other ways of thinking about that. But of course, this is not going to be a kind of a simple transition from one to the other. And in fact, we may never really get very far on it, on this road. And there's a couple of barriers that we want to just highlight here as well as a very last point. So some of that has to do with the fact that I think there's an expectation to some degree that as this sort of process of rationalization takes place, that there should be kind of a bottom-up initiatives that drive it. So mergers, collaborations within the sector to try and respond to the fact that resources are bundled in larger chunks, and in order to access them, you need to have the capacity to deliver larger sets of services. And that's the first one. The second one is that, well, even though you may have these larger contracts that may go to the private sector, that may go to the larger charities, there's still a space for subcontracting within those contracts. So a lot of the small organizations become subcontractors. And in some ways, that is sort of celebrating the diversity of the sector and bringing in the specialisms where you can. But of course, that is not true partnership in the sense that just as the funder and the contractor are in a kind of a quite a unequal power relationship, so would be the contractor and the subcontractor. So it is not simply a partnership or collaborative exercise. There's lines of accountability that are quite dominant there. But there's also, I think, quite explicit concern, and this again comes through the interviews very clearly, of mission drift and kind of prioritizing organizational survival over the organizational mission, if you like. Now, I think it's very understandable. I'm not, you know, I wouldn't be in any position to criticize that. You know, you have concern over your staff and of the existence of the organization, and you'll do what you can to keep going. But there is kind of, I suppose, resistance to some of these. One of the barriers is that kind of resistance, which comes from trying to retain status quo, trying to retain the types of practices, types of relationships and partnerships that already exist, keep going in that same direction, and possibly resist some of these changes that are taking place. And the other element of this has to do with what we've termed party political interference. And what we really mean is that I think there are instances, and again, this is, you know, in that space of people having very strong sense that this is the case, and whether to what extent it is true or not doesn't always matter as much as the sense that this is happening at a relatively wide scale, but that there are relationships within local politicians and voluntary sector organizations that get in the way of equitable and transparent policy process. Now, there's nothing wrong with lobbying your local politician in order to make your views heard, but I think there's a problem when that sort of relationship overvalues the short-term gains for either political sort of advance or for organizational benefit over long-term strategic thinking. And again, it becomes a barrier to moving beyond where we are now and kind of thinking carefully and thinking strategically how we create a sustainable relationship going forward that isn't kind of stuck in old ways of doing things, for lack of a better description. And I suppose linked to that, we also think it's clear that the policy language, the very top layer veneer of political and policy language around voluntary sector hasn't changed. And I think that's not representative of where the policy is actually going and what we can see in the way in which funding structures are restructured over the last couple of years. We can see something different happening there from the way in which the relationship is still described in sort of everyday language of policy and politics. So I'll end there. It was a time of trying to capture something of a moment of a snapshot of a very changing environment, and this is what we've come up with, and I look forward to hearing your feedback. Thanks.